Again, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
So, this whole message started with a dream that the Lord showed me, and I think once or twice I shared this during the prayer meetings. I don't remember which prayer meeting, but I think at least once I shared it there. And this happened while I was again with Patricia in India. And about a week ago, we were just talking by text, and I shared this with him. And very shortly after that, he texted me back and said, "Would you mind, you know, having this as a message on Sunday?" And I said, "Yes, that's fine, sure." So here we are. So again, the first part of what I'll really share is really just a message that I was given in a dream, and then I would sort of, we would take time to actually do a study on what truths we can get out of that and walk in. Okay. So, to start off with, the dream I had, again, it's always different. It's never really the same. What I mean by that is, sometimes I would know that, as in the dream, sometimes an angel would come to me and I would know in the dream it's an angel. Sometimes I wouldn't see anyone, I would just hear a voice telling me things. Sometimes it would be someone telling me something, and when I wake up, I would then realize, oh, that is actually something that God was telling me. Sometimes it would be, I would see myself telling someone something in a dream that I don't know in real life, and I would wake up and realize he was telling me something. So it's different each time, but in any case, this was the message that I was given in a dream. The Lord was telling me in this dream, and he was telling me in a very stern way. He was almost scolding me, as in, you know, when for those of you who are married and your wife is upset with you and she raises her voice at you, that's really how he was talking to me. You know, he wasn't like angry, but he was in a stern way. His voice was actually in a raised voice, you know, and he was telling me that you don't have the right to judge people based on where they are or what they're doing because of what he has done for them. It was a very brief message, but I woke up and it was crystal clear to me. And I'm going to say it again. You do not have the right. And it was stressed to me. You do not have the right to judge people based on what they're doing or where they are. Now let me explain. This especially applies to Christians. I know it also applies to non-Christians, but it especially applies to Christians. If you have a Christian who is struggling with porn, if you have a Christian who is struggling with drug addiction, with drugs, with alcohol, if you have a Christian who is struggling with infidelity in marriage, if you have a Christian who is struggling with just being sexually pure, whatever it is, the Lord was telling me in the dream, even if they're an alcoholic, whatever it is, even if physically you see them going through it, he was telling me in a raised voice, almost calling me, you do not have the right to judge them based on what they're going through because of what he did on the cross for them. You do not have the right to judge them.
Amen.
You don't have that right anymore. The world thinks it does, but this is Father talking to us. As far as his children are concerned, Father is saying, you don't have the right to judge them. Now, up till now, the church has done a pretty good job of that. To the point where people almost even feel safe sharing their mistakes outside the church than in the church. Because how quickly we throw stones at them. Is it making sense?
Yes.
You've heard of all the stories of how, you know, a pastor does something he shouldn't do and the church falls apart. It's because of how quickly we judge people. And the Lord was telling you in the dream, you have to understand what he did on the cross. That is the standard. That is the means by which he judges us. And only that. I'm going to repeat that. The Lord is saying, as far as he is concerned, what he went through, the experience he went through on the cross, that is what he uses to judge you and to judge other people. Because of that, whatever mess a Christian is going through, it does not change that Jesus died for them. Even if you're a drug addict and week in, week out, you mess up and you say, God, I'm sorry. And the next week, you go back to it. Or even if you struggle with immorality and you struggle week in, week out, or even if it's porn, whatever it is, masturbation, whatever it is, you struggle week in, week out, and you keep saying, Father, sorry, and you go back to it. The Lord is saying, he does not judge you based on what you are going through. He does not judge you based on the mistakes you were doing. He does not judge you based on what you can or cannot do. He judges you based on what he did on the cross. That is what he uses to judge you. And he was telling me in the dream, because of that, we should know. And he was saying to me, you, in the dream, you, and I'll say the same words to you, you don't have the right. You do not have the right to judge people when they're going through stuff. I'm repeating this because it needs to sink into your heart. It really needs to sink into your heart. You don't have that right. Because of what he did on the cross. Here's the reason. If someone was an alcoholic, and they come to church, and you relate to them as an alcoholic, or Lenny, that's been too weak. Say someone had been a child molester, and now they're Christian. The Lord is saying, you cannot judge them based on what they did, because His blood is what is used to judge that person, not what they did. His blood was judgment for that person. And even if the people fall again, he was stressful about this. Even if the person is a drug addict and they are currently on drugs, he was saying to me, don't judge them based on where they are. Use the cross to judge them. When you do that, there's a lot of things that come out of that. And we're going to study that, okay? We're going to study the benefits and the truths that come out of you doing that, you judging them through the cross. I want us to start with Matthew 3, 13 to 17. So let's go there, please. Jesus from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized by him. But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me? And Jesus answered, said unto him, suffer it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he suffered him. I want you to hold on to that story, and let's back up to Leviticus. And read Leviticus 16:21. So this is when Moses was building the tabernacle. Verse 20 says, and when he had made an end of reconciling the holy place, the tabernacle of congregation, and the altar, he shall bring. So this was part of what the high priest would do. He shall bring the live goat. And Aaron, who is the high priest, shall lay both hands upon the head of the live goat and confess over him all the iniquities of the children of Israel and all their transgressions in all their sins, putting them upon the head of the goat, and shall send him away by the hand of a fit man into the wilderness. So picture this. During the ceremony of God, of the priest sanctifying the nation, a goat will be brought to the high priest. The high priest will put both hands on the goat and literally confess with his mouth and pronounce over the goat as he lays his hands on the goat and spiritually transfer the sins. Well, the Bible says he would confess over the goat all the iniquities of the children of Israel and all their transgressions and all their sins, putting them upon the head of the goat, and shall send him away by the hand of a fit man into the wilderness. Now, if we back up again to Matthew 3:13, notice this is the point where Jesus is being baptized. And after he's baptized, where does he go to?
The wilderness.
Do you see a trend? Jesus, this is the moment when Jesus receives that, let's call it anointing, to become the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. He did not need to be baptized. He did not have to baptize, but he tells John, we need to do this to fulfill all righteousness. So John, who knew that Jesus did not need to do this, had to be persuaded by Jesus to do it. And as he does it, what happens? Jesus identifies himself as that lamb. And let's go to John, Gospel of John, chapter 1, verse 29. The next day, John seeth Jesus coming unto him, and said, Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. Behold the Lamb of God. Now every Jew understood how the sins of Israel were covered. They were covered through that goat that the priest would lay hands on. So John now understands what Jesus did. So he tells his disciples now, Behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. This is he whom I said, After me cometh a man which is preferred before me, for he was before me, and I knew him not. But that he should be made manifest to Israel, Therefore I am come, baptizing with water. And John bear record saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode upon him. I knew him not, but he that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is he which baptizeth with the Holy Ghost. And I saw and bear record that this is the Son of God. Again, that's verse 35. Again, the next day, after John stood and two of his disciples, and looking upon Jesus as he walked, he said, behold, the Lamb of God. So John understands this. John understands that this man has literally been given power to take away people's sins. Before this, no prophet ever had this kind of authority. No prophet had this kind of power to take away the sins of men. And the Jews knew that only God can do that. Only God can take away a man's sin. So when Jesus comes and he is ordained as this Lamb through this baptism, he is, you almost say, he's ordained as this Lamb of God. He is both God and he is both sacrifice. And John stands as the priest if you would, execute that ceremony where Jesus becomes that Lamb. That's why Jesus said, I need you to do this. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I wanted you guys to say this because of where we're going to. Now, I want you guys to say this. The reason why God has Jesus stand as the Lamb of God is because everything that Jesus starts to do after this hinges on one fact, that he has the power to take away sin from your life. Let's stay on that for a minute. I want the weight of that to sink in. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 15. I want to show you something. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Let's go to verse 56. So, chapter 15 and verse 56. And it says, the sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. One more time. The sting of death is sin, And the strength of sin is the law. A couple of things here. It means sin is a sting. Or let's put it this way, sin is a venom. Let's use a language that we can all relate to. This means sin is a venom. And the Bible says it's a venom. It's the venom of death. What does this mean? To understand what this means, let's go back to the Garden of Eden and see what happened. When Adam went against what God had said to him, the Bible says he died. But it wasn't just a spiritual death. Sorry, it wasn't just a physical death. It was a separation from the life of God. That really was the primary death. Because death is really just the absence of life. Okay? That's on a fundamental basis, that's all death is. It's an absence of life. So sin creates that event where the life of God parts from us. So sin is the sting of death. Now, as long as the life of God is in you, evil has no power, has no advantage, and cannot affect you, cannot overcome you, as long as the life of God is in you.
Amen.
Are you with me?
Amen.
Amen. That's right.
Now, Jesus did not just come in the stead of the Old Testament prophets to perform miracles. I want us to see this. This is something that I was asking the Lord. But what was so important? We know that Jesus came as a prophet, but what distinguished him from the prophets of old? Both of them performed miracles. Am I right? Some of the prophets of the Old Testament performed awesome miracles. So what was the difference between what set the prophet apart from the other prophets? It is this. It is the work that he does in the soul and the spirit of a man. That's vital. But he paid an awesome price to achieve it. He paid with his life. Achieve it. Now, what did he achieve? He achieved God restoring the life that man lost in the Garden of Eden within him. Man lost the life of God within him. Okay, that's what man lost in the garden. That's what Adam lost in the garden. And then Satan took over. Now, what Jesus did, if his work was like an arrow, if the work of Jesus, if you could see it as an arrow, the point of that arrow was what he did inside of you. to see this and understand this very clearly. Because it is not a theory. It is something that he did and paid for with his life.
Amen.
I want you to understand this.
Amen.
It is something he achieved, but he achieved it at a great cost to himself.
Amen.
He gave up his life for God to be able to inject back into you the life of God. What is called in Hebrew Zoe. All of you now, if you're born again now, you have that Zoe inside of you. What is Zoe? Let me explain it this way. In layman's terms. Each of you, if you were taken to a lab and your blood was analyzed, you have the gene of both of your parents. That's what proves that you are the child of whomever. You literally, you have something that comes from them. You have it in your blood. Scientists call it the gene of that parent.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is for your earth suit. Let's talk about your spirit man.
Yeah.
Let's talk about the genes of your spirit man. When Adam fell, we lost that gene. Is it making sense now?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
When Adam fell, we lost that gene. And because we lost that gene, we had no power over Satan. We had no power against him. He became the God of this world because we no longer were children of God. Because we lost the genetics of God. It is connected. So if we were no longer the children of God, meaning Satan could do what he wanted in this world and nobody could stop him. Now, what set the prophet or the savior apart was when he came. The first thing he did was he reinstated that genetics into you. The day you said, God, I accept the sacrifice of Jesus, there was an explosion of life inside of you.
Amen.
The Bible calls it that God shines light in darkness.
Amen.
Now, this is something he showed me. If you could see the life of God, okay, and you can actually see it's actually fire, it looks like fire. Okay, now that's why the Bible says light shines in darkness.
Amen.
Because the fire produces light. There are several scriptures to prove this to you. In him was, finish it, in him was
life.
No, in him was life. And the life was the
light.
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 Now that life, the Holy Spirit explained to me, that life in you, he showed me a picture, and I want to explain this to you. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for reminding me this, for reminding me about this. He said to me, your spirit, when Adam fell, your spirit was like a candle whose flame was put out.
That's right.
Okay?
That's right.
So the spirit was still there. It's a candle, but it had no light. Because the life, the gene of God. Now, if you're thinking, what is the gene of God? It's the substance that makes up God himself. When you get born again, it is put in you. The Bible calls it Zoe. It is the very life of God himself. It's like his gene. Okay? Now, so the Holy Spirit showed this to me. He said, before you were born again, you had a spirit. But see the spirit as a candle that was not lit. Okay? Now, the day you become born again, the Spirit of God comes and he lights that candle.
Yeah. Amen.
That flame, the Lord said to me, that flame, it is really a flame, but it is also the life of God. In the spirit realm, it's a flame.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
That's right.
Now you have to understand this. In the spirit realm, it's a real flame, but it's life. It's the life of God, but it's fire. That's why it produces light. That's why the scripture says, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. That's the first verse he used to back up, because you always have to do this. The Lord sometimes will use your imagination to show you stuff. Okay? Now, as a good Bible student, always ask him to justify what you're seeing, so you know it's not just it. So you know it's him talking to you. So this was the first verse he gave me to back up what he was showing me. The second verse is in Proverbs 29 or 20. It says, he said, the spirit of man is the... Who said that?
I did.
Candle. Have you guys heard that verse? Have you guys heard that verse before? I don't have time to look for it, but you can look for it when you want to. It's, I think, Proverbs 29 or so. It says, the spirit of man is the candle of the Lord.
Yes.
That's the other verse he gave me to justify when he was explaining to me that the life of God in you is a flame. Now say that with me. My spirit
is the candle
of the Lord.
My spirit is the candle of the Lord.
Now he said this to me. When God wants to give light to a place, he puts a candle there, and then he lights the candle, just like you would do. So when God wants to change the world, he gives birth to a man, and he puts the anointing on that man.
That's right.
Are you seeing it?
Amen.
In the Old Testament, it was specific individuals whom God put the light on them to be a light for their generation. You have the Davids, you have the Josephs, you have the Daniels, you have the prophets, you have the Moses, you have the Joshuas. In this day and age, it is every child of God. The day you become born again, God lights a flame, puts a flame on that candle. So you can officially understand that your spirit man is a candle that is set ablaze by God. Yeah. And that spirit is what God uses to give you light. Not just the world, to give you light. I want you to remember this. He's taking me back to something he was explaining to me recently, because I was asking him that I needed clarity on being guided by him. And he began to explain this to me. I don't know why he's making me explain it to you now, but I think somebody needs to hear it. Because I didn't intend to talk about this, but now I find myself talking about it. Your spirit man is a candle. If you're asking yourself, what does this mean for me? Have you ever been in a position where you didn't know what to do about a situation?
Yep.
Have you ever been in a situation where you didn't know what to do in that situation?
Yeah.
Okay, breaking news. There is a candle inside of you, and it is lit.
Wow.
There is a candle inside of you, and it is lit. If it is lit, it means in that candle, or where that candle is, there is light, there is illumination, there is revelation, there is direction for where you need to go.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
The Lord is tricking me here. I didn't mean to say this, but he's leading me to something else. But I'll just say this. So he said to me, this was something else that I was just talking with him about, but he's making me talk about it with you now. So, if you're asking yourself, if direction for that decision I need to make, for that choice I need to make, is inside of me, why don't I know it? How do I access it? The Lord said to me, do you remember the phrase he said? Out of the abundance of the heart,
the mouth
speaks. Mm-hmm. Again, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Again, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Let me explain to you what he explained to me. That verse means literally what it says. Your heart, when it wants to bring out stuff, it comes out of your mouth. Meaning, the connection between your spirit and the natural realm is what? Your mouth. Are you understanding?
Mm-hmm.
Let me say it again. The connection between that fire in your heart and the darkness outside of you is your mouth. Is it clicking? So, this is why it is vital that you pray in tongues. This is why it is vital that you pray in tongues. Your mouth will begin to bring out that light. The more you pray in tongues, even unknown to you, your mouth will begin to bring out that light. And stuff, ideas, things, impressions will just start to come to your natural mind, because it is coming. It is being pulled out of your spirit. I don't know why I went there, but the more I spoke, the more I found myself going there. So let's come back to the message. Okay, where was I? 1 Corinthians 15:56. So, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. So, Jesus comes on the scene, and even before he starts to perform anything, he is ordained with John standing as the priest. He is ordained as the Lamb of God. Do you see that now? The Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Now, with that in mind, I want you to see how Jesus began to do things based on his ability to take away sin. Remember what we're talking about. If you want to title this message, because I think I forgot to say that, you can title it as The Judgment of God. Because that's a huge topic. The judgment of God. Okay? So, let's see how Jesus applied and walked in the judgment of the Father. So the first judgment here is that Jesus is officially ordained. The moment John declares it, it is now established. I want you to see that. Remember, in the Old Testament, it will be a priest who would do the ceremony on the goat and pronounce the sins over the goat. Okay? But the priest had to verbally pronounce the sins over the goat. Now, John the Baptist stands in the stead of that priest. And he now pronounces that that is the Lamb that now has come to take away the sins of the world. That was a judgment of heaven.
Amen.
I want you to see that. That was a judgment of heaven. Now, Jesus began to do certain things based on that judgment. Let's look at examples of that. John chapter 8. Let's go to John chapter 8. So this is the first example. We have like three or four examples. And Jesus went unto the Mount of Olives. And early in the morning, he came again to the temple. And all the people came unto him, and he sat down and taught them. And the scribes and Pharisees brought unto him a woman taken in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they said unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery. They had to add in the very act. That means they broke open the door and they met her on the guy or the guy on the whatever it was, whichever way it was. Okay, they caught her red-handed. And they now say, now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what says thou? Now here's the thing I want you to see. Which is again what he was telling me in the dream. He does not judge that woman. Because it's not like she had just, it's not like she had done that 2 years ago. She had just done it. So, if there was a way to put it, the sin was very fresh.
That's right. Hot off the press.
Hot off the press. Okay? Breaking news.
Fresh news.
Fresh news. But Jesus does not judge her based on what she was in. He judges her based on what he could do for her.
Amen.
I want you all to see that. He judges her based on the fact that he can take away that sin. I want somebody to be set free by this. He does not judge her based on where she is, based on what she has just done. He judges her based on the fact that he can take away that sin. I want this to sink. So if you're having issues with something, and you're tired of going to God, guess what? He is not for you. You are coming to God tired of what you have been doing. Each time you come to Him, He's waiting for you to allow him to do what he can do. It does not matter how many times you fall. But the Spirit of God is reminding me to say this now. Now, when Paul talks about, now Paul had this revelation. So Paul said, does this mean that you're going to go and sleep with every woman? Or sleep with every guy because you know that the moment you come to him, he's going to take away your sins? Paul said, God forbid. But you must know. Now, here's the catch. In this example, Christ judges her based on what he could do and would do for her on the cross. Okay? He judges her based on the fact that he is the Lamb of God who takes away sins. And he judges her based on the fact that not long from now, I'm going to die on the cross for you. So I'm going to save you from these guys who want to stone you. Because I came to take away your sin. For you all here, it's different. He's already done it. For her, he was going to do it. But he still judged her based on what he was going to do. Is that making sense? He not yet died on the cross, but he judged her based on the credit that he would die on the cross for her. In your case, it's not even a credit. He's already done it.
Amen.
So it does not matter how many times you let God down. Don't let the enemy kill you with guilt. Don't let the enemy make you think you're not worthy. Don't let the enemy make you think you are too far from God. Don't let the enemy think you're not worthy to come into a church because of the stuff you've done. Jesus judges you based on what he did on the cross. Now, the Lord laid this on my heart when I was trying to understand the depth of this. It's okay. I want you to understand this. His groans were real. His sighs, when they lashed him up with the whip for 9 strokes, his sighs, his agonies of pain were real. His cries when they put the nails through his hands, those cries were real. They're not theories. They were real. They were real cries. Now, those cries were your judgment. I want that to sink.
That's good.
They were your judgment. He judges you based on those cries. He judges you based on the gasping for breath as he's dying. He judges you through those moments. For him, it was not in vain. So say to yourself, Lord, your blood was not in vain.
Lord, your blood was not in vain.
So, when you see people fall in sin, especially Christians, if you can, the best thing you can do for them is look at them square in the face and tell them the blood of Jesus was not in vain.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Because Christians can be very judgmental. Mm-hmm. But you must understand that Jesus did not use our faults as measurements for judging us. He used what he did. And that's what happened with this woman here. Can you see that? That's the only reason why he didn't allow them to kill her. Because he judged her differently from how they judged her. Now, he impresses on my heart, and I'll say this. When you walk in the judgments of God, you're going to stand out. You're going to stand out like a sore thumb. Do you understand? Let me repeat that. When you walk in the judgments of God, you will stand out like a sore thumb. Because you will not see things the way everyone does. Mm-hmm. Remember this. It was him against the crowd for that woman. Let's look at the next example. Let's go to John chapter 11. Verse 1 to 16. Now a certain man was sick named Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. It was that Mary which anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore, his sister sent unto him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom thou lovest is sick.